anybody who has a microarray experiment, I just kind of want to ask, what is your general approach? Like, if we don't have to worry about classification question, you know, you have a, most of the time, your lab or your collaborative lab generates a microarray or expression data. They have some cells, they are treating the cells with some drug or knocking out a gene or some whatever condition. And they generate the three treatment, three control. I think most of the microarray experiments are probably like this. What do you do? What are the general practice? What's the first thing you do? The microarray experiment come in cell files, right? You need to find out what's the array design. You get the CDF file. Then what do you do? You normalize, yeah, maybe you want to run the probe values on the MA plot, right, to see whether you need to normalize, okay. Most of the time you do, because microarray, you run RMA, right, the RMA will do the quantum normalization, it will do the background correction and medium polish to get you that Excel spreadsheet. And then after you get Excel spreadsheet, what do you do next? You find the differentially expressed genes. Is there something else you might want to try before this? Like, what if you don't have any genes that are differentially expressed?
Do you need more of the batch effect correction?
Yes, so when you get the expression index, you might want to run a clustering analysis to see whether your treatment controls are really separating. Right? If you separate well, fine, probably no batch effect. Otherwise, you correct for batch with combat. After you correct for batch effect, you run another cluster analysis, hopefully. Your treatment control are now separated, then you run differential expression. What do you do there? You run like LEMA, right? The LEMA will calculate the level of differential expression. It will give you the fold change. It will give you also a p-value and also FDR adjusted p-value. You can filter those genes by fold change and the p-value or FDR, right? You look at up or down regulate the genes. Say you're lucky you have like 300 genes that are up and 5 genes that are down or something. Okay, then what do? You run your hundreds of genes on David to get those genes that are upregulated. I think 300 you usually can get something from genotology analysis. And you say, ah, now I can tell my collaborator when you knock down this gene or when you treat with the drug, some pathways or some processes or some things get perturbed. Right? You can use a language rather than gene names to show them. So this is a pathway that got perturbed. And also you can run gene set enrichment analysis, like genome-wide, get all the ranks input to this, and they say, so you will give probably or something similar, especially maybe you are interested in what genes are downregulated because you only have 5 genes. That's not gonna give you anything significant on GSEA, on David, but maybe GSEA will tell you something. Okay, that's the general approach for a lot of these expression analysis, standard recipe for how to do expression analysis. Okay, now classification, it can happen. It's not as frequent, but most of the microarray experiment or expression are like what I just described. But sometimes you want classification, which also is in your homework one. We have samples here. This, by the way, is called a probe set. Most of the time now you have a different CDF. You don't get a probe set. You get the real gene name or a transcript name, right? But initially this is like AFI probe set. Each of them usually corresponds to a gene. And then you have a number of samples that are normal and a number of samples that are cancer. And you're like, oh, what is this guy? Can we predict whether it's cancer or normal? Here, you have a question.
In lab, a lot of the probe set IDs would often correspond to multiple different gene symbols I saw.
Yeah, so make sure you use the best gene CDF. So actually for the same array, Affymetrix might give you a CDF, but then also other scientists might create a more, how to map the probes to the newest gene annotation. And use kind of the gene annotation. Then each gene will give you a Even though a probe might be mapping to multi-probe set, we don't know which one is better. Just let them map and give you kind of the overall expression levels. Okay, so if you use the correct CDF, at the end, every gene should have a number. If you have multiple genes in a, like if you have multiple lines of, like, if it doesn't look like a gene name, then you're not using the right CDF. CDF is how the probes define a gene, how different probes define a gene. So you can define a gene by the probe set, you can define it by actual gene, or you can define it by the transcript, the RNA level. And so if you use the right thing, you will get a gene name. Okay? And so you get this big table. These are normal, these are cancer, and then we are trying to figure out what's these. Okay, that's a classification. That's like a machine learning, you know, you want to try to guess based on the data you have. So, this is machine learning. The task is really assign object to a class based on measurements on the object. You know, this new guy that we have microarray data on, and we also know the microarray data for the previous labeled patient. These are normal, these are cancer. What is that? New one. There are two ways to do this kind of machine learning. One is unsupervised learning. If we do not know anything about the initial samples at all, unsupervised is we don't try to learn features that separate the normal from cancer. We just do, usually unsupervised learning is just clustering. You try to cluster your unknown sample with whatever all the other samples, and after clustering, you can hopefully make the guess. Okay, supervised is if I'm already looking at the label, these are normal samples, these are cancer samples, I identify the specific features that really distinguish those two, the cancer versus normal. Then I use those extracted features to predict the new samples that I have. That's the supervised learning. You're already looking at the labels ahead of time. Okay, so the problem with unsupervised learning is sometimes you can't separate even the known classes. You cluster your samples and you say, oh, well, somehow currently even the normal cancer don't cluster so well. But if you do supervised learning, actually this is related to the homework, you can see, you can separate the cancers from normal. You can actually do a good job, except that this could be because of overtraining. The next time you use the same features, so the same genes to classify a new sample, it might make mistakes. Okay, so we'll talk about each separately. So unsupervised learning, the most common practice is to cluster the samples. Okay, so this is a breast cancer study. It's a little harder than just two classes of cancer versus normal. This is in breast cancer, there are many different subtypes. Right? There is the luminal A type. This is usually estrogen receptor positive, very good outcome. Versus this, the worst case is basal type. It's like usually young patients get it and they don't have any targeted drug. You have to use chemotherapy and they usually don't respond very well. And so the question is, can we separate them? And so you can see this is, even though previously the doctors looking at the pathology give it the annotation, the microarray experiment initially didn't have to worry about those annotations. It just says, based on the expression microarray readout, can we cluster all the samples? And very luckily, indeed they separate. Right? That's a good sign. And therefore, if you have a new sample, I don't need to look ahead of time. I just do clustering with all my existing samples. And if it clusters in here, I will say that's a basal, but if it goes into this cluster, I will call it a luminal A. And so these patients will be treated with different things and also tell patients, you know, don't worry, you have a very good outcome, or the other one, maybe we should think about some new therapies. Okay, yeah, so this is the ideal case. So if your existing data really, you do clustering that already separate, that's a good news. However, sometimes you do clustering analysis. They don't show this at all. What do you do? So this case is a clustering of K equals 1, 2, 3, 4, samples, and you only have cancer versus normal and this and no, and within the cluster, already you say, okay, within this cluster is mostly normal, but there are some cancer. Within this one, they're also mostly cancer, but a little bit normal. And then when you have a sample that's kind of in the middle, it's a little harder to predict, right? And so the reality is, when you do things like this, they will say, well, let's try something else. Try linkage, right? Because the default for hierarchical clustering is average linkage. We calculate pairwise distance. But maybe we try single or complete linkage. Hopefully, they will separate better the cancer and normal patient. Okay? And so when you are doing this, is this still unsupervised? Because you are looking at how I'm, you know, my current clustering, am I separating the cancer versus normal? If not, if I'm not doing a good job, maybe I should change, right? So in some sense, you're human, you're that supervision, right? I'm here.
Is that like a multiple hypothesis thing?
Potentially, you are doing something like that. Yeah, it's dangerous. So you could be correcting for something that's fake. But unsupervised, I would say, if your classing is really robust, it shouldn't matter what linkage you have. Hopefully the cancer and normal are really separated. Then you have more confidence in your prediction. But if in your microarray analysis, already the samples are not clustered, well, maybe you want to check batch effect first, right? And then if also, if you make a prediction, you know, if my cancers are normal, are completely separated, I have a more confidence in this new sample. But if I'm already kind of making mistakes in the known samples, then the new sample, you're just not so confident. Okay? So for unsupervised learning, in addition to clustering, there is another method, which is k-nearest neighbor. Remember where we used this approach before. Where do we use k-nearest neighbor? Last week. I think it's this lecture. Yeah, missing data imputation, right? There is, like, if you have a particular gene on a particular sample that doesn't have a readout, you look at all the other samples that look similar to my sample, and then pick their this particular gene's average expression in those similar samples to fill in the gap, right? So k nearest neighbor is you try to find k, something that's closest to you, and then decide. And so how can you use k-nearest neighbor to predict your sample of interest? It's more like guilt by association. So you have a genome-wide expression of your sample of interest, right? You ask, yeah, I do correlation of my sample with all the other samples, say supposedly I have 200 samples, 100 normal and 100 cancer. I look at this gene, I look at I look at this sample, I find out of the 200 samples, the top 10 that are similar to my sample of interest. And then out of the top 10, that's my 10 nearest neighbor. If there are all 10 are cancer, okay, this guy is cancer. But if it's 7-3 or 5-5, you can guess, you know, how confident is your prediction whether this guy is a cancer or normal. Does that make sense? So, yeah, use the missing value estimation. Yeah, so supposedly this is the sample with unknown label. You don't know whether it's cancer or normal. Find in the training data the top k number of samples that are highest correlated to your unknown. And then based on majority, you know, out of this, maybe we don't do 10. We do 9. There's never a tie. You always, like, worst case, 4 or 5, right? And based on the majority voting, you decide whether this unknown sample is cancer or normal. Okay? Yeah, so the question is, how do you determine K? You can do the K as 1, but if you're like, yeah, just one sample is too risky, maybe I should do a 2 or 3, right? You try different things. The number of K you can try by, say, if I increase my K, if I don't look at the unknown sample, I take the existing samples, I try different case. So in that sense, it's supervised again. You're trying to pick a K so that in the existing samples that you know a sample, like if I leave this out, right, you leave one sample out for the remaining one. If I try k equals 2 or 3 or 4 or 5, which one gives me the correct prediction for this unknown? So you can see, although k nearest neighbor is unsupervised, determining that k could again be a supervised as well. Now, Darius.
Is k the number of samples that you choose, or the number of, so number of samples across using all the genes, or is k the number of genes?
It's the number of samples using all the genes to find whatever, say the 10 nearest sample to your unknown sample of interest. Because those 10 have a label, you will then be able to decide whether this unknown is cancer or normal.
Okay, then why wouldn't you just use all of the samples?
Well, you have all of the samples, you have 100 normal and you have 100 cancer. And your gene is like, yeah, eventually I'm similar to all of them because they're all, after all, breast tissues. Let's just say, right? Then 100 to 100, you always have a tie. Hopefully, the data will say your sample are most closer to the cancer samples than the normal, right? Then you have better condition. That's why we want to use like nearest samples to your sample interest. Okay? Other questions? So say it's like this. This is based on two dimensions. In reality, your microarray experiment is a high dimensional data. And if your sample is like this, you do the k nearest neighbor, you actually are not as good with the prediction. But you know, supposedly if your k is around here, okay, you have much better predictive power. Okay? Okay. You can also assign weights to the neighbors by inverse distance of all the tests. I guess this is always a difficult case because it's right around the boundary, but you can see the distance of this to all the other samples that you can decide. Okay? It will just tell you, k nearest neighbor is like a black box. It doesn't tell you anything. It's just like these ones are close. But you can make a guess. There is another method that people use. It's also used for dimension reduction. You can also use it for microarray or classification. It's called multi-dimensional scaling. So you can imagine a microarray experiment has high dimensionality because you have 20,000 genes. And this one is a two-dimensional. Initially, you can think if it's only gene 1 and the gene 2 for each of the samples, right? But in reality, we want to collapse genome-wide all the expression data into this two dimension. How do you do something like this? So first, it calculates a distance. You could use, I think, correlation coefficient is reasonable. You use correlation to calculate each pair of samples to look at their distance. And then at the end, multi-dimensional scaling will pick a two-dimensional space to capture the original pairwise distance as much as possible. Okay? So it's not always a perfect solution. It will try to capture as much as possible. Depending on how many dimensions you have, so you can choose multi-dimensional scaling in eventually to have one dimension. One dimension is just on this line, these samples are close, these samples are close, these samples are further apart. So you can imagine it's impossible to capture the original high-dimensional pairwise distance, right? But you can try its best. When you have two dimensions, you can capture the pairwise distance a little bit better. With every additional dimension, you can capture the original dimension better. When would it capture the best dimensionalities? Perfectly recapitulate the original. When you have 20,000 dimensions, that's your original data matrix, right? And so you can imagine multi-dimensional scaling will just automatically find two or three or whatever number of dimensions you allow it to have in order to capture as much of the pairwise distance there is in the data. And so supposedly you have kind of a cancer normal case, and then you have a new sample. If it's here or there, you can also make predictions. Okay? This is kind of, well, this is unsupervised in the way that trying to calculate the pairwise distance of the samples. And multidimensional scaling is a command on R. You also, a new sample coming in, you'll spill out the number, you know, cancer or normal, which is pretty helpful. Darius.
So, is it like combining genes or is it removing them? So basically for two dimensions, we're not just like...
It's not removing any gene. Multidimensional scaling is just based on pairwise distance. You are calculating the pairwise distance between two samples based on the microarray expression data, calculated on all the genes that you have. Okay, well, Melissa. You can choose the genes, exactly. Well, yeah, sure, you can. So hopefully, the initial dimension can capture more differences, right? Each additional dimension will help you separate the samples a little better to recapitulate the pairwise distance a little better, but hopefully that doesn't change your final prediction too much, okay? Yeah, so this is kind of a way to visualize all of your data in a two-dimensional way. So it's called the dimension reduction technique, okay? But multidimensional scaling doesn't really actually scale your genes. You just look at genome-wide, like sample distance, okay? So that's one approach. The next part is a little harder to explain. So I'm gonna, any additional questions about that, Eugene?
So we actually don't mean anything.
Right.
So what's the difference between KNN and multiple dimension reduction? Because they are all based on the distance between.
So KNN is, if your sample is closest to 5, you don't really care what the rest are. Whereas this one is still trying to look at all of the samples together. You know, like KNN, so supposedly your sample is here. You will still pick around, you know, like maybe these samples to be similar. Right. You don't really care what these other ones, how they are spaced. You just care that the 5 closest to me, so this unknown one. Right. Whereas this, this one is still trying to recapitulate, capture the whatever distance between the existing samples and use them to help you estimate how confident you are at a new sample. Okay. Yes, sorry, I don't know your name.
Carl Tong.
Sorry?
Carlton.
Carlton. Tong. Okay. Anyway.
So when you say it's a nonlinear projection, so how do you go about doing this nonlinear projection? What's the math?
Oh, so it's just calculating the pairwise distance. So you have a distance matrix, and it's just like, how do you do this in two dimensions to capture that pairwise distance? That the original expression, it doesn't have to be expression. It can be anything. Right? Once you have the pairwise distance matrix, MDS can give you whatever this like distance approximation. It's not guaranteed to always give you perfect solution. It will just give you whatever was kind of close or far. Okay, Eugene?
Does it tell you how well it did?
Ah, I think so.
Okay.
Yeah, you should know roughly how it did. Eventually, with more dimension, you can capture more. Okay, yeah, so now we restart the move part.